I think the theme that we're trying to run through over the weekend, in lots of ways, around the First World War, is the first book. Talking about World War One is not a history lesson. Right, stuff about it. You know, obviously, there's a lot of history lessons about at the moment, right? Stuff Michael Gove included, right? You know, Gabriel Princip did shoot Archduke Ferdinand, right? Stuff. It's led off a chain of events and the rest of it, right? But the importance of the First World War and why that it's so contentious at the moment, the commemoration to the processes, is that we're still living through the after effects. Yesterday, there were 10,000 people on a demonstration in central London outside the Israeli embassy over the disgusting attacks on Gaza at the minute and the murders carried out by the Israeli military, right? So this is a direct result of the shaking of the Middle East at the end of World War One, the Balfour Declaration, the invitation for Zionist settlement and the rest of it. We've been, our newspapers and TV screens have been full of pictures of it over the last month of the breakup of Iraq, the possible establishment of Kurdistan, an independent Kurdistan. These are questions that were all being discussed and debated at the Versailles Treaty, that were shaped through the conflict during the war and the rest of it. This stuff isn't history, this is the world we live in. Right, stuff about it, and this is why it's you know, and even the situation over the Ukraine, right, stuff, the breakup of the Russian Empire, right, stuff at the end of the First World War, the Russian Revolution, the question of Ukraine independence, right, stuff, the rest of it. These are all questions 100 years later that are being fought out in blood, right, stuff, because the world that was shaped by the First World War and the treaty that ended the First World War led to more war, right, stuff, led to 100 years of bloodshed that the young kids in Gaza are still. Still suffering from, and that's why it's so crucial for the ruling class to have a battle over what happened in World War One, but particularly as well because for millions of people it embodies the idea of senseless slaughter. Right, so this is an absolutely brilliant thing. Thank you, Sarah, for this. Right, so I don't know if you've ever seen the Monocle Mutineer. Right, so a thing that the BBC showed once and then disappeared. Right, there's a reason why it disappeared. Anybody who hasn't got this should get it. It's about British troops and mutinies inside the British Army. Right, so the fact that Michael Gove is driven mad by a Blackadder goes forth, right, shows you they had a little touch on this. Why? Because when you get somebody making a famous quote that we just lost 50,000 men trying to move General Haig's troops cabinet 6 inches further towards Berlin, right? This is common currency. Most people believe that the First World War was a complete debacle, right? So, and the ruling class are still trying to shift our opinion on that. It's not particularly shocking you think it's a debacle because 10 million soldiers died, 20 million soldiers were wounded, 7 or 8 million civilians were killed, and this is without talking about the millions of people who died because of the flu pandemic and the rest of it at the end of the war. It was a cataclysm. Right stuff, but at the moment we've got Gove and the whole of the ruling class in this country, but elsewhere, desperately fighting to reshape the way we see the First World War. Because actually, if you think the First World War was lies led by donkeys, if you think that they failed then and the rest of it, it undermines the idea of us going out to fight again. It undermines the idea these people know what they're doing with really and stuff. And so therefore, there's a really, a really massive fight on. For the reasons why the war broke out and for what kind of war it was. And actually there's a pile of books. I mean, Dave Chevy's thing is brilliant, right? Stuff. There's a pile of books at the minute, it's like millions of them. And actually some of them are there from left-wing historians or right-wing historians are worth reading, by the way. I'm going to have a go about Max Hastings. I think Max Hastings' book is a really good book to read and stuff. And you learn a lot and stuff out of it, really. But what the attempt is, I suppose, is to put up two kind of key arguments, right? Stuff. First of all, is that if you put it succinctly, is to blame the Germans, right? So that's the biggest argument that's being put. That actually Britain, for whatever it got wrong, and the Allies, for whatever they got wrong, were absolutely forced to fight the war, right? Stuff over there. I found a quote in an interview from Max Hastings. He said that if Germany had won, sorry about this, I hate my phones. If Germany had won, which it probably would have done against France and Russia, allowed a highly militarised autocracy, a pretty brutal and malign force dominated by the generals would have been in charge. Its appetite for dominance inevitably increased by victory. I am convinced that Germany would have gone to war with Britain within a year or two, and Britain would have been obliged to fight alone, and that a German triumph would have been disastrous for freedom and democracy. That's the fundamental argument that, that Max Hastings, that Michael Gove, right, that David Cameron, he wants us to celebrate the war like it would be the Jubilee, and that kind of thing. That's the argument that, they're trying to put across. And the second argument they're trying to put across is all the blood and death and gore and the trenches and the butchery and the rest of it, right, stuff wasn't really senseless at all. That actually from the Allied side, they learned lessons, right, stuff over it, and it was a kind of seamless process where by the end of it in 1918, they'd learned the lessons, and therefore that's why victory came about, because the military had learned these things. And they're even trying to, you know, the thing that sums up most of all, for most people, the Battle of the Somme is the kind of key moment of stupidity in British military history, right? 60,000 people were casualties, 20,000 were dead on the first day of the battle, right? And for most people, for the last 100 years, people have said that was a disaster. Now we're told that actually it was a learning curve for Douglas Haig, right? So it was a learning curve. And you know, a year later, he learned a little bit, but he decided to throw another lot in a passion now on these 70,000. They're going through this thing, but so they're trying to rehabilitate every part of the process. And it's even on the inside cover of Max Hastings' book, what you get is a picture of people in kind of boating hats, lying around, sunny, right, stuff, you know, just, and the war has crept up on them, right, stuff over, you know, there it was, nothing much was going on, Britain was a beautiful place to live, it was sunny, and then suddenly a war came, right, stuff, and that's really when it comes down to the argument. And they use the idea of German militarism and aggression, right, stuff as being the centre point or the reason why the war broke out. And it's true, by the way, I'm not trying to argue that the Kaiser and Germany and stuff were a benign force. They were a military, aggressive nation. They were looking for their place in the sun. And I want to go through the argument about that, the causes of the war and the rest of it, right? But it's not the case that Britain was this civilising force inside in global society that was sprung on by German militarism. Britain had the biggest empire the world has ever seen. The sun literally didn't set on the British Empire. There would always be a bit of it where the sun was shining. It was built on the most absolutely brutal repression. Two things: divide and rule your enemies that you take over, right stuff, and if they fight back, you butcher them. And that went through from the what's described as a mutiny in India, the uprising mutiny in the mid-1880s, to one of the things that Dave Sherry talks about in his book, but in the Sudan in 1898, they fight this thing that's supposed to be a battle on them in the Sudan, right, stuff, but basically the British line up machine gunners and kill 10,000 Sudanese troops and lose 47 of their own, right, stuff over things. So this is a militarised machine, right, stuff that is able to butcher a great way. And actually, interestingly enough, in Max Hastings' book, he also points out that Britain wasn't this calm, civilised society just waiting for the outbreak of war. There were two things going on, or three things coming on, I suppose you could raise just little elements. One was the great unrest, the great industrial upswing that was going on inside British society, mass strikes, repression, the use of police and army against the strikers. You had the suffragette movement and stuff, brutality against those fighters for the vote and the rest of it. And you had the new civil war in Britain over the question of home rule. Well, so there was a mutiny in the British army, the Curragh Mutiny, where guns were being run into the north of Ireland for the Protestants, where guns were being run in for nationalists and stuff, and where there was a stoke up to an all-out civil war. So this wasn't a situation where Britain was kind of happily, you know, going out, boating, playing tennis and waiting, and then suddenly the noise comes in August and stuff about it. It was a brutal world, it was a brutal society where the poor were driven and were fighting back and the rest of it, and where actually Britain's colonies were desperately trying to throw off the yoke of British imperialism. It's also the case that an interesting thing about it, just as an aside, one of the reasons why everybody will say Britain went to war is Britain went to war to defend a small country called Belgium. And Belgium is a small country, but Belgium also didn't have the greatest record itself. Belgium ran the Congo. They killed something like 10 million people in the Congo in a genocidal regime run by Leopold, the King of Belgium, and stuff about it. So at the minute, the Germans are militarists, right, they do evil things themselves, but the other side doesn't look too good. And the idea that war was a surprise really it doesn't hang together either. I mean, Frederick Engels talked about, in 1887, talked about, I don't want to go through the quote because the people don't share his meaning, they heard the quote, it's a brilliant quote, but he talked about a world war being expected of an extent and violence hitherto unheard of. In other words, so 30 years beforehand, socialist people right across the globe could see that something was going on, and there was a series of wars and conflicts running up to 1914 that can't be removed from it. In the mid 1880s, Britain and France have a huge conflict over who controls Siam and the area around there and stuff, which could have led to war. There's, in 1904 and 1905, there's a war between Russia and Japan. Japan wins, sparks off a revolution inside Russia. There are two times that France and Germany nearly go to war, 1906 and 1911, over Morocco as well. And there are two vicious, bloody wars in the Balkans in the 2 years before the 1914, but stuff in 1912, 1913, where client states of Russia, Austria-Hungary, France, the rest of it are battering one another, right? Stuff trying to keep really fighting proxy wars, the kind of proxy wars that we see all the time, what countries like Russia and United States are ever fighting out today. It's not until 1904, 10 years before the war, that Britain and France sit down with what's described as the Entente Cordiale and work out their problems internationally, right? So they work out their problems in order to face down Germany. So it's not the case that you've got this, you know, calm, benign, global system that's being destroyed by upstart German militarism. The second thing really is there's another kind of key book that again I talked about yesterday by Christopher Charles, who wrote the Sleepwalkers and stuff, which everybody should get, right, stuff, which is a brilliant book, and describes he rejects the idea that German militarism is to blame, right, stuff, the thing, he describes the fact that they're all in various imperial powers and contesting with each other, the rest of it. Really, what his book kind of describes is exactly what he said, a kind of accidental war, that the alliances and the personal relations and the kind of armaments drives and the rest of it kind of mean that the war comes about in an almost accidental fashion, really, stuff over it. And in some way, there's a quote from him which is it describes it's not like an Agatha Christie novel. Right, stuff. You're not going to find the person with a smoking gun. It's much more complicated than that, which is obviously correct. But what he doesn't go through really is then what is the motive drive? Why do all these interlocking alliances exist? Why is there an arms race and the rest of it? And I suppose the point of the meeting, because Charlie Kimmer told me you have to stick to the point of the meeting, right, stuff, is to put it bluntly, for us it's imperialism. Right, stuff. That's who done it. That's the person with the gun that's smoking. I suppose this is the bit that we want to try and go through in the meeting, because I think that obviously the war comes as a complete, as Hastings' book says, a complete catastrophe. Right, stuff. And actually, many people see it as a kind of aberration. Right, stuff around it. And a German socialist leader, Karl Kautsky, who's already, you know, people, I'm going to go through it in a minute about what the left does, right, stuff in regards to the war, right, stuff. But he, in a kind of argument, a theory around it, he describes ultra-imperialism, right, stuff, says that it wasn't inevitable, that in some ways the capitalists have kind of fallen into this war, and actually maybe in the future they'll see that it's destructive. Right, so this kind of process, and maybe the most kind of enlightened or strongest capitalists in the future will be able to kind of form a cartel and stop war. We've heard these kind of arguments more generally recently. If you think about the arguments that globalisation was supposed to prevent war, people remember, you know, they were going to kind of drive the global markets across the world and stuff, and it would make it more peaceful for us. Actually, it's been the opposite. And for socialists at the time, it was absolutely crucial to try to offer an understanding of what had led to the catastrophe, and also in order to try and guide people's actions. Just before I try and go through the way people like Lenin and Makhanya and other people responded, I think it's worth saying about 1914 itself. See, we get a picture of the First World War, which is about the trenches, obviously. That's our picture of the First World War. But 1914 doesn't start off that way. It starts out with these kind of huge mobile armies effectively blundering into each other. And we think about the horrors really developing at the Somme and Passchendaele and later on in the rest of it. Actually, some of the most huge levels of casualties are in the first weeks of the war, where you do get literally armies going into battle, playing drums, wearing armour plate on horses with tufts, officers going into battle on white horses and the rest of it, and people are butchered. Right, so literally in the hundreds and hundreds of thousands, the descriptions are incredible about battles like at the Mons and other places, but the Eastern Front the same, huge areas where armies kind of blunder around for weeks, not finding one another, starving, and then falling, and then being outflanked and these huge. So in other words, you have to, I suppose the experience has to be, we're used to the idea of mass casualties and mass war, right? So people literally thought they were going to go out into a picture book battle where there'll be one battle or two battles or maybe three, and then the whole thing would be over. It's a cliche now, isn't it? All the thing about it all be over by Christmas. But people didn't think it was going to last that way. And actually the response from people, the fact that whole numbers of countries had to hide the casualty figures over the first weeks and months and stuff back, because it was just unimaginable what was going on. These people were dying in such numbers and it just wouldn't stop. And therefore, I think that's why it was so kind of crucial to offer some kind of an explanation for what was happening. And I'm trying to do it this way around, trying to offer the explanation, then go through what happened to the left. But that was obviously even more important because the left fails its test when the war breaks out. The whole of the left goes along with the war, and I'm going to come into that. What Lenin and Makhanya and Rosa Luxemburg and other people tried to do was offer a clear explanation for why there'd been the drive to war. And they rooted it in capitalism as a system. They said there was a transformation that had gone on in capitalism from kind of where there were, you know, dozens and dozens and dozens of firms competing with each other inside national boundaries. As the system developed, there was a process where the small companies were eaten up by the bigger. Right, stuff about it. And what they described as the development of monopoly capitalism. In other words, you get bigger corporations, so there'll be one or two oil companies inside Britain, or one or two armaments companies and the rest of it. And what they described, so as this happens, there's a closer and closer integration between big capital and the state machine itself. The scale of production, right, so the scale of it overflows, as they described it, overflows national boundaries. And the hunt for raw materials, for markets, for resources, for labour, means that big capital needs the support of its nation state to go out there and fight for its spheres of influence, its areas where it can rob raw materials and the rest of it. And so what you get is an outreach by nation states, where it's have to seize portions of the world, but in order to protect the portions of the world that they seize, there has to be this huge armaments race, right? So the British Navy famously was always, I think it was twice or three times bigger than any other navy on earth, because they had a global empire and they had to put the money in order to protect that empire. The problem comes as the initial big capitalist countries and stuff, Britain and France and other countries, they stake their claim out in the world, they carve it up. But what happens to the people coming up behind them? What happens as Japan emerges, as America, as United States emerges, as Germany emerges and the rest of it, they want their part too. Right, stuff, and therefore you can get a stable kind of period where there are empires that coexist with one another. The problem is there's new forces drive through, right, stuff, they want their place in the sun, and by the period with the First World War, both the United States and Germany had overhauled Britain and France in their industrial capacity, right, stuff, in their ability to produce manufactured goods, etc., etc., and they wanted their empire too. And the problem was the world was carved up. Literally, there were two states in the whole of Africa by 1914 that didn't belong or flew under the tutelage of one of six great powers. Right, stuff about it. So Germany wanted its place in the sun. It did have to be aggressive. It did have to fight for it, not just in Africa or in Asia, but on the European continent, on the European continent as well. Lenin argued that the capitalists divide the world not out of any particular malice, but because the degree of concentration which has been reached forces them to adopt this method in order to obtain profits. He said, the latest stage of capitalism shows us that certain relations between capitalist associations grow up based on the economic division of the world. And Bakharian argued that war is nothing other than the method of competition at specific level of development. So in other words, what they were arguing was that war was absolutely intrinsic to the system. Right, stuff, that it wasn't an add-on, that it wasn't something that capitalism might be able to get rid of at some later stage when they had a conference and set up the League of Nations or the United Nations or the EU or something else about it and stuff about it. They were driven to fight to get markets, they were driven into military conflict, right, stuff as part of that process. Why is that even, like, that's even more important? Because rather the position that officially socialists had taken was that socialists would have closed the war. The Second International brought together all the kind of major socialist organisations in the run-up to the First World War. It was supposed to be the organisation that took on the mantle of Karl Marx, all that stuff, and they had an official position which, if the war breaks out, we're going to try and fight to stop the war, and if it does happen, we are going to turn the war into a war against capitalism. That's what the parties did, and actually people read this stuff. In the weeks before the war breaks out, and actually as the war breaks out in Germany, there are massive anti-war rallies, anti-war protests, right, and stuff. Yeah, John Drouet, the French socialist leader, is killed in France after coming back from a meeting in Belgium where he spoke on a platform with German socialists condemning the war. So people actually think at one stage that there will be this mass anti-war movement and the rest of it. The fact that the socialist movement itself, once war breaks out though, completely turns over. Well, Rosa Luxemburg, the Polish-German socialist, argued, what did we in Germany experience when the great historic test came? The most precipitous fall, the most violent collapse. Nowhere was the organisation of the proletariat being yoked so completely to the service of imperialism. In other words, what happened is you have mass social democratic parties that have spent years talking about the need for revolution, have spent years talking about the need for mass social conflict to get against the ruling class and the rest of it. But in fact, in their practice in many countries, whites have actually fought day-to-day struggles in the trade unions, attempted to get MPs elected to parliament, have tried to use the state machine in order to get change. When their own state machines are challenged, they side with their own state machines. And so you get an incredible thing, for example, in Germany, where you get these big anti-war demonstrations and protests and people out in the streets saying they're going to stop the war. Within days, the MPs in parliament vote for the war credits and put out something which argues that we don't put the fatherland in leave the fatherland in the lurch when the war starts and stuff like that. And obviously this produces a huge crisis for the socialist movement that other people are going to try and go through in the other talks. But I wanted to just try and say a couple of things about it, because what it means is there is a clear break then in 1914 between those people who oppose the war, who take a revolutionary position, who argue for the defeat of their own ruling class, who argue that in no way can we side with the conflict that's going on, and those people who try to give reasons why in some way they have to support the conflict. And obviously nobody takes a position which is simply about that they want to support the conflict because they like war and they like destruction, they want to side with their own ruling class. They have a different reason for it. In Germany, people argue that they're standing up to autocracy and Russia, right, stuff, they want to fight the Tsar over it. In France, there are socialists who argue stuff that what they're standing up for is French culture and the idea of the French revolutionary history against German militarism. Like I said, in Britain, people argue again the same point, that we're standing up against German militarism, right, stuff, and the rest of it. So in other words, it's not put clearly, right, stuff about it, but people find their own, that socialist organisations find reasons in order to type their own ruling class. To begin with, there are only very small elements in the socialist movement, right, stuff, that stand the test. Right, stuff in Russia, but the Bolsheviks and other internationalists come out against the war, not clearly, by the way, it's not clear that they're perfect, there are arguments and all the rest of it. In Germany, people like Rosa Luxemburg and Clara Zetkin and other individuals come out against the war as well. 10 minutes, sorry, come out against the wall as well. But the real point of it is, as the conflict begins to develop, because there are voices at the beginning of the conflict who come out clearly against it, the move begins to build against war. And you get a situation from 1915, 1916 onwards, where that stuff begins to get strikes inside a number of the countries that are taking part in the war. You begin to get mutinies in the armies, and you also begin to get colonial uprisings and stuff. The example here, the most famous example here is what happens at Easter 1916 in Ireland and stuff, where there's an uprising of nationalists that like revolutionary socialist James Connolly is involved in and stuff, and you begin to get a momentum beginning to build against the war at that stage. The other point of it is really is that what there's an attempt by revolutionaries to do is then to form new organisations inside the working class that are able to give a clear opposition to imperialism, are able to take a clear position over opposition to what their ruling class has done in the war, and are able to begin to develop those forces who want to see an end to the war, and agree that the end of the war means an end to capitalism as well. So from 1915 onwards, where there's a small meeting of socialist activists in Zimmerwald, who are anti-war activists, you begin to get a process where new organisations form, and obviously where the high point of this is in Russia in February 1917, when you get the first Russian Revolution, and the revolution in October 1917 that eventually leads to Russia pulling out of the war and for a period workers being in the saddle. This is a bit that really comes back to why Gove and Cameron and others are so obsessed with rewriting the history of the war. Because in some ways, I mean, Gove's comments are aimed at what he described as an elite, right? So he describes, you know, the BBC elite, this is why they make the monocle mutiny, that's why they make these kind of things. But really what the aim of this thing is, right? So it's an attack on the left, right? So a left-wing critique of the war. But one of the main things that's missing from it, even the best critiques and stuff at the minute that's missing from it, really, is the fact that the war stops, not just through a process of military exhaustion, or not just through a process of one side beginning to develop the techniques and the armaments in order to win. It stops really because working class people, whether they're in uniform or out of uniform, begin to refuse to fight. Write stuff about it, not just at a kind of individual level, there are many heroic versions of individual level, people who refuse to fight, pacifists, etc., etc. But the shockwave that's carried out in 1917, when the revolution happens, people can't really, it's difficult to imagine. The fact that a group of millions of people in the most horrific experience that humanity probably had experienced up until that time, say they are no longer going to fight, their country pulls out of the war, has an enormous impact right across the world, writing stuff about it. And obviously the key impact it has is inside Germany, writing stuff inside inside Germany where you get a outpouring, right, stuff at the end of the war, really, stuff first of all around Kiel, where there's a naval mutiny and sailors refuse to go out and fight at the end, stuff. You get the spread of workers' councils, you get the spread of workers' councils and revolutionary uprising right across Germany, and the same happens in a number of other countries, in France, in Italy, right, stuff, the factory occupations that happen later and the rest of it. So I suppose just to finish really, it's saying this, that it's absolutely crucial for the ruling class to win the fight over the interpretation of the war, right, stuff over it. But for them, it's justifying their entire system. It's justifying the butchery that went on. It's justifying their whole history, right, stuff, which is imperial history. It's justifying military conflict, right, stuff around it. And that's why Gove, and that's why Cameron, and that's why the Tories are taking this fight so seriously, right, stuff about it. And it seems to me that that's why we have to take the fight just as seriously ourselves, whether it's in the classrooms, or whether it's in the workplaces, right, stuff, whether it's over the commemorations that happen, the rest of it. We have to fight so our side's experience, the reasons for the war, right, stuff, not reasons that were about stopping militarism or fighting for democracy and the rest of it, which were about pure and simple the carve up of the globe by one group, by one country, by a number of countries over the other. The fact that all the war did, well, really, was set up the basis for the Second World War and something for the Holocaust and for the rest of it, because the settlement of Versailles really answered none of the questions. We have to try and take up these arguments over the next weeks and
and mums and stuff about it. Because actually part of that is trying to bring people to a vision really of the kind of society that we live in. Where it's like on the one hand that they are prepared to sacrifice literally millions and millions of people's lives in order to make sure that they get their profits. But the other side of it is that we're not simply cogs in the machine. That people didn't just go through the process of the war and die like sheep. That they did put up a fight, and eventually it was ordinary people like us who actually pulled the plug on the war, right, stuff who halted the slaughter and opened up the possibility, you know, there was a possibility, but the possibility of a better society of socialists, of socialism and workers' control coming out of the conflict. So let's leave it at that.
Gove's arguments are so easy to knock down. And he says about Germany being a terrible place, and that's why we were fighting them. Except in the 1890s, his own party, the Tories, were openly touting forming an alliance with the Germans. But precisely because these arguments are so easy to knock down, they resort to another argument. And the argument is, you have to support the heroes. It's the same argument that they drag out with Afghanistan. But they didn't treat this like heroes at the time. General Haig refused to go and see the casualties. He signed the death sentences for people who deserted, over 300 of them, and many, many more were signed to penal servitude. At the end of the war, he got a country home and £100,000 to boot. During the war, they didn't talk about the heroes. There was an official inquiry into yet one of the other, another military blunder. And the military inquiry exonerated the generals and blamed who? The officers and the men. This is the truth of it. And what do we get at the end of it? We get a charity set up by General Haig of all people. You know, this is an insult. The bloke who sent people into the slaughter sets up a charity for us. And the people, the widows, of the men who were executed for desertion didn't get a pension. Out of war, they treat us as things to be exploited. At war, they treat us as cannon fodder.
Just to talk about what's clear about imperialism. In 1869, France finished building the Suez Canal. This was shaped the course of events cost the Middle East. In 1871, we know that the Franco-Prussian War ended, and it moved on to 1873 to a financial crash. In doing so, Britain turned around, who had previously no interest in the Suez Canal, and took £4 million to buy an Egyptian share of the Suez Canal. It then put boots on the ground of Egypt to fight, as previously mentioned, the wars in Sudan, and at the same time, signed a treaty. So now everyone knows that the Suez Canal is safe limits, no fighting over the Suez Canal. Straight away, Britain is now into the Middle East. This is all done by finance. This is imperialism. In 1899, Baku is the world's largest oil producer. 50% of oil comes out of Baku. Intervening events, you see other nations competing. You've got the Berlin to Baghdad Railway, finance capital building into British interests. You've got the Turkish oil company. You've got different finance all moving into the Middle East, prospecting, looking for oil. Germans have a sort of little hoo-ha with the British over parts of the Middle East, which Britain concedes that you can traffic, you shipping there, but please leave South Mesopotamia alone, that's ours. And you see the bartering and trying to find ways in order to put finance capital there. Massive amounts of money spent looking for oil. In the end, we get the Anglo-Persian Oil Company set up. And Churchill in 1913 signs a deal with these companies in order to supply oil to Britain before 1914. He wants to change the ships to oil-powered machine gun for domination. You can see finance and capital being spent in order to secure interests in the Middle East. And to me, that's what causes World War I, that finance capital.
Yeah, I want to talk about something we've been doing inside schools to actually stop Michael Gove's agenda being put forward. And I'll tell you what, it's really important because kids are being taught that the Germans were to blame, they'd been taught as a regular thing. The kids are going over to the battlefield sites in Belgium and France and been told there, this, you know, it's a glorious war for democracy and stuff. And we need to make sure that doesn't actually happen in our classrooms, because that's a really crucial battleground. I'm a teacher in a secondary school in North London, North East London, and we set last year Gove tried to change the history curriculum by writing it in the back of a cigarette packet of his words or something, and he actually wrote down his own curriculum, and we actually we set the thing called Defence School History, which actually stopped that happening, and so it stopped it happening. He actually couldn't get away with his curriculum. But what he then did is in January he wrote the article in the Daily Mail where he actually puts forward this argument. And that has had an impact inside teaching inside our secondary schools. And that's really important because obviously that's what kids are going to find out about. So we've actually renewed our efforts in Defence School History. And we're saying basically we want to make sure that the Second World War that's taught in our schools is actually the Second World War of reality. The one that you grew up with, the one that you know about, the ones that, you know, things like Wilfred Owen, the poets of Wilfred Owen, the things that we know about in terms of the slaughter in the trenches, the reality of the war, the horrible, nasty, horrible of the war, horrible reality of the war, and also, of course, who's to blame for the war. The idea that the Germans were to blame for the war is, again, another thing that came out. In my lessons, one of the lessons I taught, I remember we talked about who's to blame for the war, and one of the kids says, well, who do you blame for the war then, Germans? I said, no, I blame the system, and that leads to a whole load of arguments and discussions, and from that, but loads of really interesting discussions. One of the students came to me yesterday and said, "You're going on the anti-Israel, you know, Palestine demo." Same student who asked me about, which is what I say, really important. So, just very quickly. So, what I'm saying is, Defence School History. One of the things we're trying to do in terms of actually raising that issue and making sure that stop Gove.
We have a number of people who have indicated, and we do need people to stick to 3-minute limit, please. Thank you. It's now 4 or 5. No.
Yeah. Andrew Smith, Lewisham branch of SWP. I'm not going to be at Marxism this afternoon. I'd like to be here because there's a whole load of meetings on the First War, and I can't get enough of those meetings. I've been to Honey Rosenberg's meeting on 1919, and I've been to Dave Sherry's meeting. But the problem for me is that I've been taking part in a community festival in Sydenham, which runs over 2 weeks, and they are commemorating the First War. And I've even taken part in a four-part production. There's going to be another part this afternoon, which I'm going to go and see, which my partner, my wife, is taking part in. I'm a member of Sydenham Choir, and we've been trying to tell the story of the gas workers. In fact, Eleanor Marx, you know, who founded the Gas Workers Union, also lived in Sydenham. And I'm not quite sure whether this is a progressive production or not, because, you know, I've read about the commemoration, Sarah Cox's thing, I think in Socialist Review or the paper, you know, about how they were trying to commemorate the people who won medals and how they're trying to, you know, restore a problem, our interpretation of the First World War. Well, I can't describe everything that happened, but our first play opened with the soldiers coming back from the war, but five of them were dead, one was alive, there was a lot of bitterness and argument, and then I realised that one of them had actually been shot, so that seemed to be quite a promising start to the play. But then we went into the jingoist songs, which I sung with aplomb, and I thought one of the songs had actually been, you know, made up for the play, but actually it was a song researched from Lewisham that was sung at the time, a terrible jingoistic song, and underneath there was another round about arrogant Hun. But I don't think this was the intention of the people, you know, who were producing the play, and I want to see how these plays go over the next 4 weeks, because I want to argue with people in my choir about the causes of the war and the rest of it. But the other thing I wanted to ask, the real reason I put my hand up, just a very quick question. Is the war being celebrated or commemorated in Russia? Is the war being celebrated or commemorated in Germany? And if anyone can come back on that.
Yeah, it's funny, I've just come back actually from Belgium on one of those sort of tours, you know, and my dad asked me, do I wanted it, you know, would I like to go, you know, to see this, you know, these commemorations? And I thought, well, I'm not really jingoistic, really, because I'm a socialist. I don't particularly want to commemorate that. But I'm actually glad I did, because not only is Belgium very flat, what you get, you know, apart from in the many graves, is, you know, they've got original pillar boxes, and you know, they built Talbot Green, I think it was the major sort of cemetery, the British cemetery, which were all very neat. And, you know, and they built it around the original pillar boxes, which they fired on, you know, which must have been at that time absolute carnage. Of course, in, you know, to come back what people are already saying, and if you look at the Menin Gate in Ypres, you know, it's a Greek Romanic sort of structure, which they've built. And on there is 54,000 names. What's that about? They're the bodies they never actually found, just in Ypres. So I think it's interesting just to go over and just, you know, and just sort of get your head around it, the actual, you know, futility of it, I think. And of course, like, you know, the history of any history of the victor, the first casualty is the truth, isn't it? You know, of course, you know, the way Gove is and others, they don't want to talk about the truth. And I think really only from a Marxist sort of dialectical historical analysis, when you put into question the economics, the political, the historical analysis, why that war happened, can you have, I think, a more fuller, grounded understanding, I think, which you know, the speaker talked about. Thanks.
If anybody's got any simple questions to ask, can I encourage you to do that? You don't have to come up and speak for the whole 3 minutes.
I mean, Michael's absolutely right. This isn't just a history lesson. And the arguments that Lenin put forward about imperialism, we don't have to defend every exact word, every letter, but the method remains indispensable. Imperialism, the process of capitalist development is not even. It creates a hierarchy of states, but that hierarchy is never stable. And that creates what Lenin called the constant drive to divide and redivide the world that can lead to imperialist jostling around the periphery, think of the scramble for Africa. But that can then come in to the centre of the system and you see open clashes, indeed all-out war, between imperialist states themselves. And I think that the 21st century, we are seeing a sharpening of inter-imperialist challenges and clashes. If you think that the experience since the 1990s has been of the major imperialist state, the United States, crushing and attempting to crush a series of smaller states, more on the periphery of the system. What we're now seeing, I think, is a re-emergence after 20 years of more open clashes. Nothing on the scale, of course, of the First World War and so on, but nonetheless, politically, this is incredibly important, between imperialist states. Think about Ukraine, the jostling between Russia, a more confident re-emerging Russia, the European Union, and America. But I'll tell you where the real show is in the South China Sea, where the rise and industrialization of China is now seeing the Chinese state beginning to try and exert its influence in the crucial shipping lane that feeds the world economy. You have China, the world's second biggest economy, beginning to square up with Japan, who've just changed their constitution to allow them to intervene outside their own borders. The world's third biggest economy, allied to the world's first biggest economy. Right, this is serious stuff. And actually, one of the arguments you get on the left is to look at which is the kind of lesser evil. You know, we should have illusions in China or Russia and so on. Let's just come back to Lenin. Lenin, in 1915, says the states that are going to war, Belgium, Russia, and all, are all slave owners. Look at the slaves they had in the colonies. They are slave owners. If you have a war, they're not all equal, but if you have a war between a slave owner with 200 slaves and one with 100 slaves, you don't say which is the lesser evil. You support neither side, but you attempt to use that war to get rid of all of the slave owners. And that's the approach we have to inter-imperialist competition in the 21st century too.
I'll keep it very brief, try to get a bit very brief. Dave and Michael have gone through a lot of the background to the First World War, and I don't need to go into any more of it because I think there's enough people want to talk about it here. What my indication is, my concern, and I don't live here any longer, so I'm doing it from a respectable telescope, is that Gove and the rest of this gang under Cameron are using the First World War to express a sense of Britishness, of British culture, to try and counteract UKIP and all this other shit that's roaming around in the undergrowth. And this is serious because it's quite easily translatable. Not for adults who can think about it, for a lot of people, a lot of children, to translate the so-called First World War background of the British Empire doing this to our sense of Britishness. You know? Now, to finish, we have a royal family who escaped from Germany, shall we say, 1837, Victoria the founder. We had Battenberg, who the provincials managed to assassinate, whose family connections, funny enough, are with Ferdinand, the man who got shot by Prince. So, you know, if we're talking about Britishness, let's start with the bloody royal family. Let's go to them first.
Hi, thanks. I'm Ray Owen from Chesterfield, Socialist Workers Party. I've got one simple lesson about the First World War. It's the same lesson about any war. 1956, I was 18, and there were $3,000 on different parade grounds in Yorkshire, in Kettering. And this little old man, he had whiter hair than I had, and he was 4'9", and he's walking onto the parade ground, and these 3,000 kids all lined up, cattle for slaughter, all lined up, and he walked on, and he had to get onto a fruit box to speak through the microphone so people could hear him. Gentlemen, you will be pleased to know, today we declare war on the Arabs. They've stolen our canal that we paid billions for. We paid, like he bragged it with his invention. He invaded it, or he invested his millions. He had nothing of the sort. And he was telling us, he was imposing his idea that we're going to defend the empire. We are 18-year-old kids. I didn't have white hair then, I had black hair, believe it or not. And the parade ground came to attention on that signal. We all stood up and, my God, and all of a sudden the air was covered. The sound was horrific. It was like a volcano. We all farted at the same time. And it was blue. I was sick to death in it. There was kids that sat on me who were farting away. It was like a cannon fire going on. And the silly old bugger tried to get his sword out of the scabbard, and he had to drag it out 3 foot at a time. It was 4 foot taller than him. And he's doing this, he nearly stabbed himself, bringing it to the end. He had no idea what was going off in front of him. He didn't know it. And this is the real issue. It's not pride. It is about empire. It is about colonialism, it is about all of that. But the important thing is, we got down to, just outside London, getting ready to go to, and we loaded all these 76 tanks and 3,000 men onto one ship. Can you believe it? 3,000 kids my age, and some old men who were leading us. And we got onto the ship, and the ship went down 6 foot into the sea. And it chugged out of the channel, went down, and it turned round in the Baltic, in the bay.
He's on the
and voice came over. Ladies and gentlemen, he was a Yank. You'll be pleased to know we're going back. We're going back. Boat went out of the sea 20 feet. Relief. God, I'm not going to die. And we're all the same.
Sorry,
and the issue is, The people who take us to war because they enjoy the trail of death. They enjoy ordering people to die. And that's what imperialism is all about, and that's what the First World War is about.
Just a question I've got here. I'm going to start from the gentleman, a comment started from the scramble for Africa, and particularly where it was the European War. But my question is the involvement of black fighters, free slave, unfree slave in the European War. That seems to be written out of history, not included the Algerians, the Angolans that fought untold. The only job they can do is dig grave. I'm in favour of the free black workers, people within the Second and Third World War.
Thank you. Yeah, it's another question. My knowledge of World War I was limited to history O-level, so that's a long time ago. One of the things about becoming a Marxist is that the dynamic of the system becomes apparent and it starts to make sense of the detail. However, I have a question, and it is, where did the Ottoman Empire and the Austro-Hungarian Empire fit into all this?
A question. One of the stories that most people know about the First World War is the story of Edith Cavell, who's a British nurse who was shot by the German army, I believe, for allegedly spying.
Can you speak nearer the mic, please?
Now you've killed it.
Is that any better?
Yeah.
My question's about Edith Cavell, the British nurse who was shot by the German army for spying, I believe. I was recently watching the TV series The Crimson Field about British nurses in military hospitals in the First World War, and an aspect of this story that I had never heard about before came up. One of the British officers, when this was being discussed by the people who ran the hospital, when he heard about the shooting of this nurse, asked what had the British government done about it, what protests had they made, how they tried to, at least negotiate to try to save her life. And it turned out that they'd made very little protest at all, that in fact that virtually nothing had been done by the British establishment to negotiate with the German army to try to save her life. And one of the officers in the hospital, once he heard this, he said that it dawned on him why this had been done. There's nothing like the shooting of a nurse to spark up support for the cause at a time when it was fading and recruitment in the British Army was falling off. And according to all the history of the First World War that I was taught, this actually worked. Apparently there was a massive surge in recruitment after the shooting of Edith Cavell. Now, as I say, this is an aspect of the story I've never come across, and I wondered if you knew anything about it.
Speaking to the last speaker today, but if you have indicated in this meeting, I'll be chairing the next two, so do feel free to come back to the next session.
There were two questions asked. One was the First World War being celebrated in Germany, and the answer to that is no, it's not. There's very, very little mention of it in Germany at all. Mainly, I think, because of the devastating effect of the Second World War on Germany and the whole question of Nazism and so on. In fact, there are very few monuments to First World War left in Germany because of the destruction. Of course, well, there are some. The second question I asked to the Hungarian Empire, we could be here all day talking about that. I think we have to see that people talked about the imperialism and, you know, small imperialisms and different imperialisms. We have to understand that Germany wasn't
only by the time of the First World War had only quite recently been united as a country, and that there was always a contest, if you like, in German, German national, German nation, if you like, between Austria, Hungary and Prussia, based around Berlin and so on. And it was only with the disintegration, the collapse of Austria-Hungary, that Prussia and Otto Bismarck managed to unite Germany and then came to an understanding about where it was in relation to the rest of imperialism, and so did set on, you know, trying to carve out its own empire. But the thing I want to talk about was actually fact, well, we talked about the what Gove and so on are trying to do about, talk about the First World War is an ideological battle about reclaiming its history. Actually, I don't think they've been tremendously successful. I was prepared this year for a huge barrage of these things and flag waving and so on. And it hasn't materialised yet, maybe still to come. But I think because of the terrible facts of the First World War, that, you know, the battles that were fought in previously, I mean, because Gove cites Joan Littlewood in her play, Oh What a Lovely War, I think that these, you know, if you like, these cultural artifacts, this memory of working class people of what the First World War is still quite strong, I think, it was like, and that, you know, despite, you know, the overwhelming resources of Gove and Co, that the people, the things like that Phil and Defence School History have done in terms of pulling that back in schools and also challenging the interpretation of Gove is absolutely central, because I think we have to find, you know, the thing we have to finally say about it is, of course, that the First World War was ended, first of all, by the Russian Revolution, obviously, in 1917, but also crucially by the German Revolution. You know, but the fact that the German soldiers and sailors then Kiel first mutinied, began the revolution, actually meant that, you know, the Germans could no longer fight on. And, you know, I think that is the real thing they want to bury, isn't it? The war ended in revolution.
Three or four quick things. The first thing that maybe raised the thing about black soldiers, really, and stuff, and the whole thing about people from what they describe as the colonies. See, troops were used on a massive scale. Millions of people and stuff from all over the British Empire, from the French Empire, and the rest of it, stuff were thrown into the meat grinder. That's what happened around it. And you're right that their role is completely ignored, but in lots of ways, in the way that the role of ordinary people throughout the war is ignored. The beautiful thing about the First World War is it's a world war. You can go through, I mean, Dave Sheeran went through, yes, you go through every bit of the globe, both conflict on land, but also on sea and the rest of it. It embraces everything, and every part of the empires are mobilised, right, stuff around it, and partly because the part of the, you know, the war's root cause is this desperate attempt to bring, could grab different parts of the globe and stuff around it. It's worth reading Dave's book. Some of the things he goes through, reading stuff about the issue of black soldiers who were involved in the British Army and stuff, and the mutinies and the rest of it, and their treatment, right, stuff, is really, really impressive. He went through that the other day at the meeting. The second thing is, people raise the thing about Austro-Hungary and the rest of it. I mean, I don't know anybody else, right, around it. For most people now, these empires are just names, aren't they, right, stuff, you know, the Ottoman Empire, the Austro-Hungarian Empire, this sort of thing. What it was really about, like, wouldn't it really, is it's all this stuff is about survival of the strongest against the weakest, and these empires are thrown into a battle where actually lots of them think they're going to take a piece and they disintegrate. Look at what happens in Russia. Russia enters the war, right stuff, with the idea that it's going to march into Germany, right stuff, you know, seize land, right stuff, new territories and the rest of it over the thing. Actually, the Russian Empire collapses under the weight of the war. It's exactly what happens to Austria-Hungary. It's exactly what happened to the Ottoman Empire and stuff. The Ottoman Empire had already lost loads of territories during the Balkans Wars and the rest of it. And so what this is about is the destruction of old empires and development of new empires. So what's the, in lots of ways, what's the big powers that come through in the war? It's when the United States starts to project power on a world scale, right, and stuff from 1917, 1918 onwards and the rest of it. So you're right, you know, in lots of ways it's about the kind of processes that we see today and stuff, where there are greater powers or powers and stuff that start to have less of a punch and a battle with each other and the rest of it. I don't know the details and stuff around it, but what I do think around it is that's the other part of it. See, one of the problems with the history that we get go back to Gove histories and the rest of it stuff. It's a kind of military history and a history of politicians. One of the things that it's trying to steal away is both the role of people inside what were described as the colonies, also the role of women, the role of working class people, and fundamentally, right, it's the fact that all those elements inside society eventually rebel against the war. Everybody rebels against the war, and that's the bit that's missing. The soldiers rebel against the war, workers rebel against the war, women rebel against the war, the colonies rebel against the war and stuff about it. And what they're trying to do is go back to a sanitised view of history, and that's why the stuff around them, and I agree with the woman who was raising the thing about how it can fit in with the kind of Little England, the UKIP type argument, but the whole thing about trying to find a rational argument, right, so why they fought the conflict, right, is very important for them, because for most people, they don't see it as a rational thing. The other thing around it really is an argument that Dave raised and hasn't come up in the discussion as well, but our analysis of it means that we don't only see the First World War as this kind of evil process, but we see the same processes driven in the Second World War, right, stuff around it. These imperial conflicts, right, stuff about it. So we see a difference between, there's a difference between fascism and the German regime in the First World War and the rest of it, but the drive to war is all about the carve up of the world, the carve up of resources, right, stuff, and the rest of it. And that's the bit that Govan people really are trying to move against. I suppose the last thing really is about, are they going to be successful doing it? Right, stuff like that. In a minute, I'll agree with Dave a bit and stuff. They have got a problem, really, stuff over the issue of the First World War, because millions of people in this country and in other countries, right, stuff, really see it as an utter folly. Right, stuff, when they go through the facts, you know, lots of people do know, we can talk about their history's taught in school and the rest of it, but things like the song are bywords, right, stuff, for foolishness, right, stuff about it, and for the waste of human life, right, stuff around it. And that's why they find it difficult to do this, and that's why it is possible for us to put up a fight. It was interesting, at the Unite conference, right, stuff, there was a motion on the First World War, wasn't there? Right, stuff about it, right, stuff. We're trying to put an argument about the kind of conflict that it was, and we do have to take that argument up, really. And so the last thing of all, really, is about the question of workers' power, and the question of the role working class people can play, right, about it, because that's the biggest part that's written out of the thing. That war stopped one big, you know, after 4 years, the most horrendous carnage, because fundamentally, right, stuff, sections of our class pulled out of the war. We refused to fight. We didn't just refuse to fight. We started to construct another kind of society, and in Russia and other countries, people were prepared to fight for that other society. And so that's the other bit that people are going to go on to, the revolutions and the intervention against Russia and what went in Germany and stuff between 1918 and 1923. But we have to fight for that part of the interpretation over the next couple of weeks and months, because it didn't end because the generals decided it would end at 11 o'clock on the 11th day, at the 11th hour, and the 11th month, and the rest of it, right? It ended eventually and stuff because working class people refused to carry on going through the carnage year by year. And that's the kind of power that can stop wars in the present day as well.